This type of carving basically fell on my lap when my grandmother passed. My grandmother, who was from Adakmagug, Peskotomuhkati, or Passamaquoddy, when she passed away, she was my connection to everything, from language to traditions to all of it. And like a lot of other young Indigenous people, they really don't take advantage when they're young. And when she passed away, I realized that everything changed immediately, and everything was in my hands. It's been 3 years now, maybe closer to four, that I've done nothing but carved. And as soon as I put one of these in my hand, I'm sure people feel it all the time. It just feels I'm in the right place. I've done this a lot before, and nothing makes me happier. And then when I add a place like this, when I'm doing this, and the ancestors are here more than I can even imagine, and they're constantly guiding me. So when I say I'm a traditional carver, I try to take it to the next level. Everything is done by hand. Mallet, chisel, and hand sanded. And if I can do it, bit of rain, bit of snow, it doesn't matter. As long as I'm outside, hearing those sounds, seeing that river, it's a very special thing. I want to show the art that comes from my culture. They're very proud. Everything my people do is done to 110%. And I want to show this on a little bit bigger scale. So they realize when they see everything else from, like I said before, our snowshoes, our baskets, they're the most beautiful in the world. And we take serious time and pride. And that's what I want to accentuate. Why I do this is because it brings me attention. The attention I want to bring is that we have some of the best artists in the world here on the East Coast Canada and Wabanaki territory. And that's what I want to bring, is because, like I said, we are nomadic people. So our art had to be functional art. And a lot of art in the world is not functional, and people are not used to functional art, that it can be beautiful and functional. So what I'm telling people is, yes, these are beautiful, but my people originally, like I said, they would have been smaller. But my people would have been doing the canoes, the baskets, the paddles, the snowshoes, the things that were saving their lives. When I got into this, the school wanted me to teach it to everybody, this type of carving, this traditional type of work. But I had some grandmothers come to me and say, listen, our people need this retaught first. So at some time, yes, but for right now, if we can concentrate on our people, let's do that. And that's all it took. Even here in Wabanaki territory, non-Indigenous people have not a clue. So when I talk about occupation here, how long my people have been here, how old some of the artifacts that I have right inside, 7,000, 10,000 years old, and they're blown away. And then you have things like where this river, Wolastoq, now it's called the St. John. It's been called the St. John for the last 200 years. For at least 11,000 years, it was called the Wolastoq. And we are known as the Wolastoqey, the people of the beautiful and bountiful river. So this is gonna bring more knowledge and realize that even people around here, I tell them that now, and they're like, well, why is it called St. John? And I say, exactly. But the more knowledge I give, it seems like it's opening people's eyes. For my own people to get that reconnectivity back, it is worth its weight in, I don't even know, diamonds right now.